Hello and welcome to Microsoft Digital Now. I'm Andrew Wilson, Microsoft's Chief Digital Officer. Today, technology is at the heart of every business. Its mission criticality, its speed, is something we're all having to deal with. On this series of conversations, I'm looking forward to speaking with friends, industry leaders, both within Microsoft and across the industry, about how they're tackling digital and wider business transformation. So let's get to it. Today, we're talking cloud. I'm delighted to welcome to the show, Scott Guthrie. Scott, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me, Andrew.
Scott, you lead the Microsoft cloud. I imagine that history, that scale, that journey must have been quite the ride. Could you talk us through it?
Yeah, it's been quite a journey. I mean, sometimes it feels like just yesterday, and then sometimes it feels like 200 years ago.
You're looking younger than that.
Oh, thank you. It's definitely aged me, but it's been a fun journey. I mean, when we started the Microsoft cloud, our real thesis was around, how do we be the cloud for business? And how do we be the cloud that really, enables our customer success? And, we really try to envision, a cloud that would both help with infrastructure be flexible enough that you could run any workload in it. But at the same time, we really embrace SaaS early and platform as a service and this notion of managed services and this idea of let's not just provide VMs, but let's really look at how can we take cost out of the system? How can we provide, more value that just gets better automatically every day? New features come out, patches are handled for you automatically, and really composes together. And I think it's not perfect, but the way that Azure and Teams and Office 365 and our security portfolio and now GitHub and our developer tools and our Dynamics business and Power Platform and most recently Nuance and our industrial clouds, it's kind of coming together in a way that I think composes to ultimately deliver, customer value faster and really enable that customer success. And so that's the journey we've been on. We're still working on it. And you're going to see it continue to improve in the years ahead.
I mean, I've run more than one organization, which has been wholly powered by the cloud. Now, Microsoft, that's where we first met. In those early days, I remember thinking about adoption. I remember thinking about security, mission critical, tolerance, resilience, scalability. How easy or not was it to convince the first customers to move mission critical over to Azure?
Yeah, I think some of the first, big workloads, and I remember back in your past when, we were working in terms of a giant SAP deployment. And, customers are always sometimes worried about being the first. Mm. Part of our strategy was, especially for the first big customers that were doing mission critical, how do we really build a tight engineering customer relationship so that we could sort of say, look, we're going to make you successful. And, we're not just going to be a vendor, but like, how do we really be a strategic partner that can help with that transformation? And I think back to a lot of those partnerships and a lot of those engagements really helped us grow. And I think we helped, thankfully, pretty much all those customers be successful. And, I think that's been key for us throughout the whole period of the Microsoft cloud of, continuing to kind of drive improvements and then really have this sort of symbiotic, deep partnership. That's given our customers confidence to bet on us for even more mission critical workloads. And now, we run hospitals, we run giant manufacturing facilities, whole governments and legislatures are running entirely on our cloud. And, it literally is mission critical. We even have workloads in space that are connected. It definitely is a huge responsibility. And
previously workloads in the ocean as well.
Yeah, we have workloads underseas. It's kind of amazing just the breadth and the diversity of it's in Disney World, the parking lot in Disney World's wired up with IoT. It's kind of fun to actually kind of have this digital technology really integrated into the fabric of society, both in terms of IT but also increasingly OT. And that combination is really special.
Microsoft's enterprise credentials, I think, certainly helped in the early days. To me as a consumer now, the cloud is so deep, so wide, so rich. there's so much there. The stack is enabling of the entire enterprise, but the sequence of adoption and when you see a customer really getting it, what pattern they use, and any top tricks from a customer perspective where you say, yeah, this customer knows what they're doing. They're adopting, they're getting value, and that's a pattern you recognize. Could you call out any of those for those who are still on the journey?
Yeah, you know, I mean, I think for a lot of the journey, it starts with migration of existing workloads. And so, you know, I think that's important, but I think it's really critical that that's not the only step, because if you're simply moving something from an on-prem facility to the cloud, there's benefits, there's savings, but the real benefit is when you start to take advantage of what the cloud has to provide. You know, let's take the elasticity of workloads. And so, you know, retailers or other companies, you know, they have, you know, Black Friday and the holiday season, or, you know, if you're a sporting company, you've got the championships, or your media company, you've got, you know, the Olympics, or you've got the Oscars. And how do you take advantage of the elasticity of the cloud to kind of surge when you need it and then bring down your resources? That's a huge cost driver and saver. You know, how do you leverage the managed services, whether it's, you know, database as a service instead of running a database in a VM, whether it's around Kubernetes as a service rather than, again, trying to manage and care and feed and patch a Kubernetes cluster on your own. You know, whether it's analytics as a service, you know, each of those things, when you can take advantage of a managed service where patching is provided, security is provided built in, backup is automatically integrated, DR is automatically integrated, you can really take cost out of the system. And then the thing I kind of really recommend is, you know, how do you take that cost savings and then invest it to drive innovation? And, you know, whether it's, you know, leveraging something like GitHub and creating kind of more of a DevOps-like model where you're creating custom apps, or whether it's low-code, no-code with the Power Platform where you're automating what were previously manual or, you know, multi-step human processes. You know, how can you do business process automation? How can you take advantage of RPA? You know, and that I find is exciting, because then that's when you're really transforming an organization to be much more digital. And where suddenly the technology teams, even in what might not traditionally be considered a technology company, suddenly become one of the most important assets in that organization. And you can kind of feel the energy in those environments where suddenly the IT teams or the OT teams are suddenly the heroes, and they're really driving the business agenda. And, you know, not every company goes through that same arc, but I do generally see that pattern as the maturity continues. And it's, you know, it's one that I think is exciting, because it really has business impact. And it's obviously, you know, exciting for us because it gives us the ability to kind of introduce new technologies that keep driving that digital agenda even further.
As we looked at our own transformation here in Microsoft and our own journey to cloud, I think we quite quickly concluded this isn't just another compute solution. This actually rewrites the DNA of the IT team. It's a different governance model. It's a different consumption model. We have a cloud control room. We think about Azure optimization. And I think, as you said, it's about how much can we get out of cloud for how efficiently, and therefore what can we redivert spend-wise? Yeah. And I think that's a strong theme with customers who gradually realize, perhaps more progressively realize, that this is a game changer across all of the services that they can offer to their business.
You know, you think about where the economy is right now in the world, you know, it's you know, we'll see what the future brings. But, you know, I think every organization right now is feeling the pressure of inflation and like, ooh, we got to spend more just to keep the lights on. And, you know, a lot of markets are struggling to hire people and talent. And so it's, you know, you have this sort of double whammy of costs feel like they're going up, and yet you can't hire enough people to do the work. And, you know, at the end of the day, you know, the thing that I think hopefully will be the salvation is really about bending the curve of productivity, you know. And I think the exciting thing about technology and the business that, you know, we're all in, including everyone watching this, is, you know, our ability to leverage technology to do more, you know, without having to spend a lot more. And, you know, to be able to do more without necessarily having to double or triple your headcount. In some cases, you know, how do you automate contact centers using AI and some of the work we're doing with like Nuance and Dynamics 365 Contact Center? You know, how do you help with physician burnout with things like Nuance and some of the solutions we're doing for healthcare? You know, again, how do you enable dev teams to be more productive with kind of a full DevOps-like set of capabilities with GitHub, including things like Copilot, which is our AI code generation assist technology. You know, I get excited because each of these things is about, you know, really putting fuel behind an organization's business, helping them do more with the same number of people. And, you know, I think it's going to, those types of solutions and those types of business outcomes is really what every organization is going to need in the next 2 to 3 years. You know, as we go through this period in the economy where, you know, we're dealing with inflation, dealing with the challenges of hiring enough people. Again, I think this is a real opportunity for IT and technology teams to be the heroes inside their companies.
There's never been a better time to be in IT.
Yep.
I was going to ask you, by putting you on the hotspot, what could we expect next? You've given us quite a rich list there, but if I were to probe a little bit more, anything else that from your perspective we should look to cloud for next that perhaps we don't see that much of today?
I think one of the things you're going to see over the next couple of years is this shift to very large AI models that can comprehend language, can comprehend speech, can comprehend computer vision in ways that were unimaginable 2 or 3 years ago even. And you know, we're a pioneer really, I think, in Azure with the partnership we have with OpenAI, where you know, we're training these models and we're running these models. And I think you're gonna see these models start to be integrated into every business process, every application, every consumer experience. And you know, I think that's going to be an exciting time where, you know, whole industries are going to be transformed and accelerated as we really start to apply this AI technology. And, you know, expect to see a lot more of that in the years ahead. And again, I think it's going to help really with productivity. I think it's really going to help in terms of enabling new solutions. And it's going to ultimately help organizations save a lot of money and at the same time drive their business forward in new ways.
An exciting future, and one where we technologists are rewriting our roles again. Responsible AI comes to mind as I listen to you there.
Yep.
We're change managers, we're business influencers, we're strategists.
Even think about sustainability, you know, some of the work we've done recently with the sustainability cloud, the Microsoft Cloud for Sustainability. It's, you know, how do you use technology to really, you know, if you're in retail or you're in manufacturing, you know, rethinking supply chains where, you know, a huge amount of carbon is emitted both by manufacturing things, but also shipping things. And, you know, it's exciting to see, you know, IT and technology suddenly being in a seat where, you know, measuring carbon, measuring, you know, net zero initiatives, and then being able to kind of, again, whether it's using AI or business process to kind of reimagine how all this is going to work. You know, it's the impact, I think, as technologists, all of us, again, watching this are going to have is enormous and beyond kind of what you might think of as the traditional role that we've had for years. It's really going to be in the physical world, the OT world, and, you know, broader environment at large.
Powering every dimension of the business, every customer channel, the employee experience. We could speak for hours, Scott. It's fascinating, particularly when you've lived that journey as you have. If I were to take you back, though, I'm assuming you couldn't have predicted this for your career. When you were a little guy, when you were a boy, what was your dream job?
You know, it's funny. I kind of went through the arc of many different ideas. I want to be a film director at one point, and I want to be an archaeologist at another point. And, you know, someday I want to be a history professor. I'm not there yet, but you know, someday I can dream. So it's I have lots of interests outside of technology, but at the end of the day, technology won my heart, and it's been a good career.
We haven't spoken about the pandemic, but you mentioned your interests. When you were in lockdown with your family, any new hobbies, or what did you spend your time doing when you weren't running the cloud?
You know, I do lots of like non-cloud hobbies. And so, you know, I collect stamps, and I got into model train layouts during the pandemic. And so, you know, I learned to cut wood and electricals, and you actually don't really do much with trains, it turns out, with model train layouts. You mostly do a lot of woodwork and a lot of, you know, modeling and plaster and all that stuff, and create a whole mess at my house and learned a bunch of stuff and had fun. Didn't look that pretty in the end, but it was a good way to keep me busy.
Well, I've had the pleasure of working for you for the last 2 years, and indeed I'd asked that question before, and in fact you'd shown me some of the product of your labors. On behalf of everybody on Digital Now, we'd like to say thank you, not just for your leadership, but also for joining us on the show today. So in here, we have a little gift for you. It's reflective of my hobby, Lego, which I think you also might be, it's a train.
Wonderful.
In fact, and because you're a Lego enthusiast and because I know you're passionate about trains, this is the new passenger train. So I'm hoping
that
you and the family don't have this. So this,
is a
little gift for you. Thank you very much for joining us, Scott Guthrie, on Microsoft Digital Now.
Thanks for having me.
Coming through, Scott Guthrie wardrobe. Which green room? Scott Guthrie wardrobe. Scott Guthrie wardrobe coming in now.